us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we want to thank you for your love. Lord, there is nothing we can do to make you love us less, and there is nothing we can also do to make you love us more. Lord, we thank you for your love. As we present to you this worship, as we remember the sacrifice that you gave, Lord, we thank you. Bless it, bless us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Okay. Once again, it's my privilege to welcome you all to our Balaam Seventh-day Adventist Community Church. We hope that you will have a lovely moment with us. And I would like to know if any visitors with us for the first time in Balaam, if you could raise up. Or any members who notice a visitor, can you stand and introduce that visitor for us? Because they might be shy, but yeah. Okay. All right. Any member noticing any visitor? Yeah. Okay. Welcome. Coming from where? Sorry. Okay, Pastor will introduce them. So welcome again. I hope you have a lovely time with us. May God bless us all.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. It's a joy to be here today, and the honor and privilege is mine to introduce to us our speaker for today. It's amazing the way God works his miracles. By yesterday we had different plans. And late in the night, we were made aware of one who is going to worship with us. And it's a tradition in our church. We are always delighted to give such individuals. Dr. Delbert Baker is not a stranger here. He tells me he has been to Balaam before.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Yes. So when I was saying that Jonathan is a visitor, he says, no, Jonathan and Susan have all been here before, so they're no visitors. So the privilege is mine to welcome, to minister to us today, none other than Dr. Delbert Baker. He is the second Vice Chancellor of the Adventist University of Africa in Nairobi. And you know something about Nairobi? That's closer to where I come from. And before taking on that post, which started this year, he served as the General Conference Vice President. Before then, he was President of Oakwood for many years, and he's not a stranger to many of us. We know him as one who has been pivotal in leading the work of God, especially among our communities. He's not only an educator, a preacher, a teacher, an author, but he's a pioneer. And he tells me that he has a passion to see the education work, both in Kenya and the whole of Africa, reach new levels. And the amazing thing is, within the year that he has been there, he has seen God fulfill that vision in a very amazing way. And I say that I was not going to spend a lot of time speaking. We're going to invite him to share with us. So today I want to invite you, Dr. Roberts, to be able to come and share with us. We'll invite you at the offering time to share something with us. But he's not here alone. He's here with his wife, Dr. Susan. Welcome. And their son, Jonathan, and his wife and daughter. We also welcome you to worship with us here today. During the offering, Dr. Roberts will share something about what he's doing. And then later, he will minister the word to us for the divine service. Am I the only one welcoming him, or all of us would like to welcome him to Balaam?
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Our opening hymn is hymn number 320, Deeper Yet. Number 320. 302, thank you. Someone's on the ball, that's good. Can I ask you to stand while we sing this song? In the blood.
Thank you.
seated.
For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. I know all the fowls of the mountain, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell thee, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. Will I eat the flesh of bulls, or drink the blood of goats? Offer unto God thanksgiving, and pray and pay thy vows unto the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver thee. Bring ye all the tithes into my storehouse, and prove me, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour thee out a blessing, that you will not have room enough to receive it. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we do thank you, Lord, for blessing us this week, for health, for strength, for food and shelter, and for work. And we thank you, Lord, for giving us the opportunity to return to you our faithful tithe and offering. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The deacons and deaconesses shall now collect the tithe and offering.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'd like to say it's a privilege for me to be with you and my family. I'm going to ask if they would do me a favor. I want my wife to come stand by my side. She's in Africa with me, so she's standing here. What do you say?
Yeah.
Please come up, Susan. I'm going to ask my son, Jonathan, and his wife, daughter, Jasbir and Simon, would you please stand briefly so they can see you? They were kind enough. We're actually on our way on our annual leave. We're leaving Africa, going home. And so we stopped by to see our family right here in London. Well, I want to say that we're coming from a wonderful place in the heart of Africa, in central, East Central Africa, Nairobi, Kenya. The pastor said he's from that area, so he knows it very well. We have come to really enjoy Africa in a special way in just the 1 year that we've been there. Now, I've been to Africa 35 times prior to coming, but this is the first time we've lived in Africa. And we are thrilled with what God is doing at the Adventist University of Africa. What I'm going to ask, if they will quickly show these slides that I gave them. You don't have to wait for me to speak to them. Just kind of go through the slides as we're talking and keep it moving because we have a very limited period of time. The Adventist University of Africa is a general conference institution in Washington, D.C., but it's established on the continent to serve three of the world divisions there. The West African Division, the Southern Indian Ocean Division, and of course the East Central Africa Division. The three divisions are sponsored and worked with by the University of Africa. You say, well, what do? They give graduate programs, they give master's and doctoral programs for primarily the workers there, but really it's not limited only to workers of the Adventist Church. Anyone can go to school there. It's a lovely campus, and just right outside of Nairobi. And Susan and I have the privilege of being there. I'm vice chancellor or president, as we call in the U.S. We have approximately 800 students that attend school there. And since 2009, they have graduated 430 students. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Now you say 430 students. Well, when you consider that the school only started in 2006, that's very, very significant. Say a word about it, Susan, your impression, please.
Well, good morning first. Good morning. Happy Sabbath to you. Great, great. I felt right at home here, Pastor, because when the pastor said welcome them, everybody went like this. And
that's
in
right.
Africa, that's just
what
they do.
They do this.
So, and then God is amazing because the pastor is from Nairobi.
That's right. That's
How
right.
about that? Kenyan. You come so far and everything is so much the same. But we are really pleased to be here with you today. Anyone here been to Nairobi? Adventist, have you been to the university?
No.
Advent Hill.
Okay. Ah, great, great. Well, would it be appropriate for us to extend an invitation to anyone here who would like to come? It is an experience you would not forget, really. We live in a beautiful place. It's almost like a Garden of Eden where we are. They are right outside of Nairobi. The university is a place that is training workers for the entire continent of Africa. And it's really a pleasure to work with the pastors, the leaders That's who right. are there getting advanced education, getting graduate degrees so that they can better serve the Lord and better serve the needs of the community. But now we are really trying, one of our emphasis is to get more female students. I heard a good amen for that. Right, I'll take right. that back and tell them that here in London they were with that. So that's great.
The last thing we want to say is that there's a way that you can help the Adventist University of Africa. You can pray for it, you can give special gifts, if you will, and you can also support it by talking about it to people who you may know are going or in the area or thinking about our graduate program. It's a dynamic area. God is doing a special work with us, with the school, and we've seen in so many remarkable ways that God has moved. Let me tell you this in closing. It was in 2005 that my wife and I went to Nairobi for a visit, just going through the area. And when we were there, we said we heard about the special school they're developing. The General Conference is developing the school right outside of Nairobi. So we got a driver, and they took us out there, and we saw the foundation in 2005 of the first building of the Adventist University of Africa. We looked at that place, and I said to my wife, we're at Oakwood then. I was president of Oakwood University. And I said, if there's one place I would leave Oakwood University for to come and work, it would be this place. And little did we know that some years later, about 10 years later, here we are at the University, the Adventist University of Africa. So God is good. We thank you, and we pray that as we worship together, we all will be blessed. Keep us in mind. Thank you.
I have been talking about taking people from Balaam who want to go to Kenya. And some of you have said, when is it happening? And I was thinking, where do I take you to Kenya? So already have gotten the invitation that if ever we turn up in Kenya, we must go and visit the Adventist University. So begin to prepare your wallets. It has to be early next year. We were hoping to go in August, but they have elections in Kenya in August. Either we go earlier or later, but we will try to work that one out. Amen? Also, it's a joy for me before we have the meditation to welcome in our midst our South England Conference, Dr. Richard DeLisa and his family, and we're truly honored to be able to have you worship with us today. And we will love if you can just say hello to the brethren.
Let me greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. It's indeed a privilege to be here this morning. Thank you, Pastor Mbui, for your kind words of introduction. He's been a special friend to me. I want you to know that. Yes. Pastor Mbui has been very, very gracious to our family. He's a chauffeur, not just a pastor. And he's a very good friend of mine. I just want to thank the members for praying for me. As many of you know, we lost our mother a couple of weeks ago. And she's going to be buried on the 29th of December at the Brixton Church. So continue to keep us in your prayers. Okay. And may God continue to bless you. And we just come to worship with you this morning.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. To ready us for the message that the Lord has for us before we partake of the communion service, we are blessed with a meditation from Sister Marie and Hope Young. Thank you very much for ministering in the word after them. We're going to have our speaker today, Dr. Dalbert Baker. Thank you.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place, and we can feel his mighty power and his grace. And I just pray that we will all be blessed as we worship together in the presence of the Lord. Thank you.
One of the items I didn't mention to you this morning is I'm proud of the fact that beside being a U.S. citizen, I'm now a true resident of Africa. My wife and I, we received our residence number in Kenya, and so now truly I am an African American. This morning for our communion homily, a brief word from the Word of God. I'd like you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Hebrews. What did I say?
Hebrews,
a very familiar passage that you know very well, but in it is a profound and a lasting truth. Something that it's good that you can do a checkup on at the end of the year. 2016 is coming to an end, and all God's people need to do what I'm calling this morning a faith check. A faith check. Say that to your neighbors. Say, a faith check. I want you to do a faith check this morning and see where you are in the faith of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And Hebrews talks about it in a very specific way. In fact, one of the most known and referred to passages in the Word of God. If you'd be so kind this morning and join me in standing as we read the Word of God, Hebrews chapter 11, and I will read in your hearing a few verses from there. Hebrews chapter 11, and I will begin reading with verse 1, Hebrews 11. The Bible says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, that is faith, the elders obtained a good testimony. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of the things which are visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and through it he, being dead, still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found because God had taken him, for before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God." And verse 6 is perhaps the heart of it. "But without faith, it is what?
Impossible.
It is impossible to please God or him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him." And verse 7, let's read it together. "By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith." Let us pray. Heavenly Lord, we thank you for the word of God, and we thank you for this year that you've given to us. And now as we come to the end of 2016, we ask that you'd help us this morning to do some introspection, looking at our hearts and our minds, and do a simple faith check. We invite the Spirit of God to convict us and to speak to us. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. There is in Africa a fascinating animal that has caught my attention. In fact, it's the Big Five. I have a particular interest in the Big Five, the lion, the elephant, the rhinoceros, the buffalo, the tiger. These are ones that people from around the world, they come to the continent and they seek to find these Big Five and they hunt them because they are the most dangerous and the most difficult ones. But there is the African impala, who is fascinating. This very strong and powerful creature is fast, very difficult to capture. They have kind of a sense of they're in tune with nature and that nothing can really hold them down or keep them in one place. They can jump to a height of over 10 feet and a distance of greater than 30 feet. I mean, they're incredible. It's almost as if they're flying. Yet these magnificent creatures can be kept in an enclosure in a zoo some 3 feet in diameter. Why? Because the animal just won't jump when they're enclosed like that. You say, why won't they jump if they have this great ability to jump so high and so far? Why won't they jump? The animal won't jump if they cannot see where their feet will fall. So in that enclosure, they're so confined that they don't see where they can jump and how where they will land. And as a result of it, they do nothing and they simply stay there. I am suggesting to you this morning that faith is the ability to trust where we cannot see. And with faith, we are free from the enclosures that life and fear hold us with. In fact, fear is one of the greatest things we have to be sensitive about. We're afraid of the fact that we might become ill, or we're afraid that we won't have money, or we're afraid that something may happen to us, or we're afraid something may happen to our family. And fear can actually paralyze us. So then how do you deal with the fear as you come to the end of 2016? How do you deal with the reality, the fact that the world is a dangerous place? You do have things to be careful about. How do we deal with the fear factor and still allow ourselves to be at liberty and free and to trust and to believe? How do we do that? Hebrews has the secret in there. In these verses, it talks about people who preceded us in life and history, who dealt with the same challenges in context that we deal with. And yet they were able to surmount these fears and these problems they had and to grasp hold of something bigger and greater than themselves. Faith, what about faith? What a simple check. What is a simple check we can do with faith to see where we are with this whole faith factor? Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. So Paul says in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1. He says that there's a tendency for Christian people, for believers, to know something, to have it in mind, and yet with time we slip. We understand it intellectually. We have it in our thoughts. We know the fundamentals of the belief. We know the Word of God. We know what we believe in the sense that Jesus died for us. And yet, when the problems come our way, we often let go of that belief or let go of these things, and we cease to keep our hold on Christ and His Word. Why does that happen? Well, the Bible tells us that the devil is diligent in that whatever he can do to take your faith away, to rob you of your belief in God, that's what he wants you to do. He causes you to feel that you're too sinful or that you have done wrong and God no longer loves you. You may have been walking the straight path for, let's say, a few months and you did a sin. He will bring to your mind, you've done that sin, and so therefore you're out of the hold of God. He no longer loves you. He makes you feel that God really doesn't notice you, that you're simply a small person, a nobody in the middle of a vast amount of people. God doesn't pay attention to you, so why should he have concern about you? The devil also takes advantage of your own insecurities and your own foibles. He makes you feel that because you have these internal problems and because you struggle inside, therefore God doesn't really love you and the faith doesn't work for you. And then he takes this and he robs us of the very belief that will keep us and sustain us until the very end. But Paul deals with that. He deals with the Hebrews. He knew that they were struggling with that same situation when he wrote the letter to the Hebrews in the New Testament period. He wrote it because people had a tendency to once know about the sacrifice of Christ, to know the fact that he died, but they didn't make the link between the fact that he died and his death was for their sins, and no matter how bad they were, if they could have confidence in the sacrifice of Christ, they have salvation. That's what he's trying to get across in the book of Hebrews. He diligently sang to them that Christ lived, he died, and he's interceding now in heaven. And by placing your belief in him, you have the assurance of eternal life. That's his point there. And he makes it very clear. He says that by having faith, you have power to deal with the challenges of life. Yes. Let me show you that. Go back to 11th chapter of Hebrews. And I just want to walk these verses one more time and look at that and see the power that Paul says we have as a result of having faith, simple faith in God. He says, first of all, that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That's the power of vision. Faith says that even though you don't see God, even though you don't see spiritual dimensions, that because you have placed your confidence in the Word of God, you have the right to believe that just as He said, He will do. So you say, but how do I know that? How do I know that? Because you believe. It's the substance of things that you're hoping for. You hope this will be true, and the evidence of things that you can't actually see. He says, I have salvation. There's a heaven waiting for you. I will give you relief from your sins if you will have faith. That is the power of vision. If you can grasp that concept, if you can put your arms around that, you have the right to know that it's going to happen in your life. Now that's first. First of all, we had to see the power of vision. But not only that, he says in verse 2, by it, for by faith that is, the elders obtained a good report. That means a good reputation. That when you have this faith factor, when you have faith in your life and you believe in God and He's going to do what he says that is the power of reputation, meaning that it will give you a good report. God says, if you rest on me, if you put your weight on me, He says, I will not let you down. Amen. I will cover your back. I will cover your sides. No matter what mess you get yourself into, if you have faith, I will provide for you. Amen. Now you say, but what if I make a mistake? Well, often when we make mistakes, we have to pay for that mistake. If a man is intoxicated and he's driving when he's drunk, and if he makes a mistake, if he harms someone, that is his fault. He will go to jail. But he still can be accepted by God. God will forgive him. God will accept him. We have to pay for our sins, and many times things that we've done wrong, we deal with the penalty of that. There's no excuse for that. People make a wreck of their homes or their marriages or their jobs. They pay for that. That's the penalty you pay. But still, you have your salvation secure in Christ. He will cover you. He will take care of you. Power, not only of a vision, but of reputation. Then verse 3, it says, through faith we understand the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. That's the power of stability. I don't wonder. I'm not thrown off by evolution. I'm not thrown off by the different theories of men that are in society, that are on television, that are in our schools. I know that this world was created by God. Amen. In 6 literal days, and then the 7th day He rested. And so therefore I'm not confused about that. Faith gives me that assurance. It gives me that rock solid conviction that even as I believe, so God has done it. Amen. Now I must confess, some people look at that and say, well, that's foolish. How can you do that? Is that intellectual? Well, I think it is intellectual, because I have studied the Word of God and I found that the Word of God is reliable and true, and I can depend on it. I have faith in it. Amen. It's my faith check. So we see there is the faith of vision, the power of vision and reputation and stability. And then I love this one, verse 4. It says, by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaketh. That is the power of service. Faith tells me that by giving away, I receive. Amen. By helping others, God brings to me the things that I need. It doesn't really make sense. By giving away, I receive. But I've seen it time and time again that God is good, and He will bless you as you bless others. And so the whole idea is that as I rest on faith, as I do my faith check, I ask myself, am I giving of my life and my time? Am I supporting people in the body of Christ? Am I supporting people in the community around me? Am I supporting people in the job and the workplace? We at AUA, I think about this often. We have the Advent Hill. It's a lovely situation. As my wife was saying, we have Maxwell, we have the division office, Maxwell Adventist Academy, the division office. We have ADRA there. We have GCAST. All of these places right there on the hill. But surrounding us, there's a city, Ngatarangai, that badly needs the services of Adventist Hill. So what do? Do we stay among ourselves? Do we keep all of our goodness, the health truth we have, the message on clean living, moral living? Do we keep that to ourselves? Or do we say that God has given me a faith and I will give this to other people and let them be blessed even as I am blessed? That is the power of service. And so we want to witness and share even as you are doing in your congregation right here in this area. You don't want to keep your light under a bushel. You want to share it with others. And I think of a situation that happened some years ago. I love to run marathons. I love to do that. And I've run more than 50 marathons in my time all around the world. And I remember my first marathon that I ran, it was many years ago. And I remember a friend told me about a marathon. It was 26.2 miles or 42 kilometers. And that was, I had never run more than 10 miles in my life. This was back in the late 80s. And so I said I was going to run this marathon. I just jumped up and said, my wife's a physical therapist, and she said to my husband, Delbert, honey, you're kind of losing it here. This is not a good thing. You don't run a marathon without exercise. But I remember we said, okay, I said, what I'll do is I'll run a half a marathon. I won't run the whole marathon. I'll just run a half a marathon. So that's what we plan to do. We went down to the Capitol, Washington, D.C., and I remember they had some 12,000 people lined up to run the Marine Corps Marathon, and I was going to run half the marathon, and that was going to be what I was going to do. And I remember I started off in mile 5 and 6. It was so difficult, so strenuous, and so tiring. I thought, I can't do this thing. I went to mile 5 and 7 and 9. I barely got to 10. I thought, well, I don't have much more to go. When I reach 13.1, that's half a marathon, my family will be there greeting for me, and that will be the end of it. I never will forget, I turned the corner by the Capitol. That was the halfway mark, 13.1. And I saw my wife and I saw my 3 sons there, and they were so excited and surprised that I made it this far. They saw me, I came up there, and I said, I'm just gonna drop out here, I'm gonna stop right here. They said, Dad, Dad, we're proud of you, we're proud of you. If you've come this far, go ahead and finish the rest of it. And I remember, I guess my hubris or whatever inside of me kind of welled up and said, I said, my son, I got 3 sons, my wife's there, I got to keep on running. And I did keep on running, and I think at a mile 15, 16, I thought I made the worst possible decision in my life. Every single bone in my body was aching. I was purely on autopilot. I was just going on. I will never forget. It was a life-changing moment. There was a white man. He came along and he began to talk to me. Practice, and you've never run a marathon before. I believe you can finish this marathon. He said, in fact, what I'll do, I will finish it with you. Mile after mile, 18, 2, and as we talked, was there with me, helping me. We got to mile. No matter how tired you are, no matter how fatigued you are, that a see the finish line. You can see. We came to mile 26.2 is left. And at that point, I turned to Sandy, who was still with me, and I said, listen, you've helped me so much. I said, I owe so much to you. You cross the finish line first. He said, really, the truth of the matter, mile 17, even though I've run marathons before, he said, when at mile 17, you, and by helping you, I'm able to service. my sisters and brothers, as we end, the greatest powers that you can receive from your faith is the ability to help. And who knows, by but as I a vision and a reputation, it says, by faith, Enoch was him. He didn't go in the grave, but he's translated from this. In Christ has glory with him. Don't forget that. In the your own internal challenge. Life is not all there is to life. There is an eternity to come. Not just for now, but there is the future ahead of us. The broken body of Christ, the fact that Christ gave his life for us, life in his death. Amen. Christ, that's our destiny. The greatest assets. As I get older, I recognize the fact that I've got more years behind me than in front of me. Stay with that. It's not all over then. Comes as I have faith in his Son, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that I have away from me. Amen. You can take my life, mishap that might happen, but says that what I have believed, he is the author and the finisher of my faith, and he will see me through. And that's the hope I leave with you this morning. And I want to end with this final text, verse 6, that I think is so classic. I don't know if you've noticed this passage, but this is probably one of the most encouraging aspects of the faith journey. Because, see, some of us don't have a lot of faith. Some of us struggle. We just went through the story of Job in the Sabbath school lesson. We studied a lot about Job. My wife teaches the Sabbath school lesson at AUA, and we talk about a lot at home about the lessons and what Job went through and the terrible trials he went through. And I fear that a lot of times when we face our trials, our faith check just doesn't work. And something happens. We set our faith aside when we come to our trials. And we face terminal illness and we say, oh God, why did you let this happen to me? Or problem in our family. Oh God, how did you let this happen to my family? And we often are tempted to give up our faith, our belief in God, the fact that he is in control of your life and nothing will happen to you except he allows it to happen. And Job brings that out in a very graphic way. Job so shows that you don't know the whole picture. You're struggling with your life and you're struggling with your problems and you think you're all alone. But really, if we could see the divine perspective and see that God allowed this for a special reason and he's working out his plan behind the scenes, even though you can't see it, we would be encouraged. And I often see the 40th chapter of Job and chapter 41 and 42 when Job had all of his fortunes reversed and he had twice as much as he had before. Sometimes we don't get twice as much as we had before. Sometimes our problems they remain a problem until the very end. God doesn't take them away. He doesn't remove them or double our fortunes. But I do know, even if he doesn't, I've got a reward in the life to come. And that's what my faith tells me. It assures me of that. So here's the point in verse 6 that I want to leave with you. It says, but without faith, therefore, it is impossible. You just can't do it. You have to believe. You have to set aside your doubts and your agnostic beliefs and your atheisms. You have to set them aside and say, I choose to believe God because I want to please him. And without this faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is. Otherwise, you're making a mockery of him. Why would he bless you if you don't believe in him? That's the transactional arrangement. You come to him, you say, I'm a sinner, I'm lost in my sins, I've got a problem, I don't know how to deal with my life. So I'm coming to you, I'm giving you all of my problems, and I'm believing that your righteousness is able to cover me, and I will not doubt, I will not question you, I will believe. It's a choice. It's not a feeling. Ellen White makes it very clear in Steps to Christ. She says, it's not a feeling, it's not an emotional passing sentiment that you have, but it's a belief that what he says in his word, I can depend on this and he will carry me through. So it says it's impossible to please him without faith, and the one that comes to God must believe in fact that he is. And then it says, and that he is the rewarder of them, meaning that he will give you everything you need of them that diligently do what? Now that word seek is a very powerful word in Greek. Seek says that you haven't even found him. You're just seeking. You're just looking. What it says is that God has the faith structure set up for imperfect, failing, weak human beings. Which means then that in your faith walk, a lot of times you stumble and you fall short, right? But what? You're still seeking him. Have you found him yet? Maybe, maybe not. But you're seeking him. I know in my heart that God exists. I know that he is real. I know that his word is substantial and reliable. And even though in my walk I make mistakes and I make a mess of things, I'm always seeking and moving toward God. I'm always looking to him for his guidance and his direction. I'm seeking him. I'm seeking him. I will not seek him. And he says, as long as you have this desire in your heart, as long as you move toward me, as long as you seek me, you diligently look through me through prayer and Bible study and going to church and helping others and just believing, he says, I will reward you. Amen. I love that. Can you say amen? He is a faithful God, and he is one who blesses those who diligently seek him. You don't give up. In spite of your doubts, in spite of your fears, in spite of your sins. Ellen White said, it is not the occasional deed and misdeed, but it is the tendency of your life. Yeah. The seeking aspect of your life. You say, well then, will I ever know God? Yes, you will know him. You will know him. In fact, you will all know him finally when he comes the second time. Everything we have now is imperfect. We have imperfect aspects of God. We study him, and as we study the word of God, more and more we're seeking him, we're getting a better understanding of the word, but we'll never get it totally, completely, fully. No man has seen God and lived, but we can seek him. So as we end 2016, the faith check says, do we have the vision, the reputation, the stability, the service, the destiny, and always seeking God? If we can say that, if we can simply say in our hearts, Lord, I know I'm imperfect. I know I don't have it all together, but I'm seeking you. And you have my total commitment. I will give you everything I have. And day by day, I'll become changed in your likeness. I'll become more and more like you. If you can make that commitment, my sisters and brothers, you have the assurance to know that the righteousness of Christ will cover you, that he is with you. No matter what happens to you in this life, God has it under control. He will cover you, and you have nothing to fear except you forget how he's led you in the past and his teachings. I was thinking about the subject of faith, and I ran across this true account that happened in the 1980s. There was a photographer in the U.S. who was a skydiver. And the skydivers, you know, they're the ones who, they go up in the planes and they put the parachutes on and they just jump out and they just have a wonderful time. It's exhilaration. It's a great feeling going down the plane, and they pull the chute and the parachute comes out and they have a gentle, safe landing. Well, the skydiver was also a photographer, and he took a group of people up with him to the plane, and he was going through the exercises, and what he was doing was he was filming each person as they jumped out of the plane and they plummeted down to the ground, pull the chute, the parachute comes up, and they gently land. So this was a live exercise, and the people down below were watching this in real time, and as they saw the different people come out, they saw the parachutes come out. It was such an exhilaration feeling and seeing how everything worked so smoothly. And finally, the skydiver, who's a photographer himself, he jumped. And he jumped, and he jumped. And they saw the movement as it was moving out of the plane, but then all of a sudden, everything went crash and berserk, and they lost the signal. What had happened? Well, in his excitement, in his exhilaration and filming others, he forgot to connect the parachute to his own chute. And he leaped out of the plane and fell to his death. And it was really interesting that for a moment, there was this feeling of high. And when he jumped out, they saw the things until finally everything just went. When he started off right, but he didn't have the proper safety net, and he never made it successfully. I see that as symbolizing how faith is to our lives. We can have a good beginning. We can be in it for a good while in the faith. But unless we have that parachute of faith that sticks with us to the very end, we won't make it safely to our destination. And so I challenge you this morning as we're about to enter into the communion service, that you will do a simple check in your heart and say, Lord, is my faith in place? Have I recognized the fact that I am a sinner and that I have fallen short of the glory of God, and the fact that I need your saving righteousness to cover me? The fact that you lived a perfect life, that I have lived an imperfect life, and if I accept you as my personal Savior, you will cover me with your righteousness. I am justified to stand before God as if I am perfect because of Jesus. Have you done that? And daily, do you give your heart to God and say, Lord, here's a new day, and I give my plans to you. I give my life to you today. You be in charge. And then you say, when you sin and you fall short, you simply confess those sins. And say, Lord, I blew it today. I didn't do what I should have done today. But I know that your grace is sufficient, and you will cover me. That's the faith walk. That's the faith check that I'm leaving with you today. Ellen White says that those who love Christ, those who follow him according to his word, she says, that if they look steadfastly unto Jesus, if for a moment they take their eyes off of Jesus and they fall short of his glory, she says, the fact that they have sinned does not make them less dear to the heart of God. That's a wonderful truth. When I was a young man in college, that was one of the quotations that just changed my life around, knowing that God wasn't waiting for me to find where I fell short of his glory, but he loved me the way I was, and that his righteousness covered me. And even when I had fallen short, he still loves me, and I'm still a part of his family. Amen. That has, through the years, kept my faith strong. And I trust it will keep your faith strong as well. Do you love Jesus? Amen. Can you say amen?
Amen.
He's brought you through 2016, and by the grace of God, you're ready for 2017. Amen?
Amen.
Let us bow our heads as we pray. Father God, we thank you this morning for the simplicity of the Word of God. Faith, the substance, and the hope. We pray that we will just renew our faith to you today. Renew, first of all, our relationship with you as our personal Savior. And then renew our commitment to your Word and to following through. And even as Hebrews 11 brings out, that the power that comes through faith will be realized in our lives. But I pray for my sister or brother, Lord, who is weak, who is struggling. Help them not to give up hope. Help them to keep believing, to keep trusting, to keep seeking you, and you will ultimately do your perfect work in them. As long as we keep our hand in your hand and keep moving or choosing you as our Savior. I pray that as we enter into this communion service, that you might bless the emblems, bless every part of it, and bless every partaker, that as we end this year and we prepare for the new one, that your Holy Spirit might fill us with all the good gifts we need and all the strength we need and all the hope and optimism, believing in your soon coming and the rewards that you have promised. In the name of Jesus Christ, let everyone say, amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We would like to thank Dr. Baker for the reminder that we just need to remain faithful because God is indeed able. As we, before we partake of the emblem of God's broken body, of Jesus' broken body, we'll just reflect on Mark 14, verse 22. Mark 14, verse 22, and it says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them and said, 'Eat, take, eat. This is my body.'"
Shall we kneel as we pray on the bread? Our Father and our God, we are so thankful to you for the great sacrifice that you have made on our behalf. We thank you for such great privilege to partake of these emblems. As we partake, O God, we ask that your blessing be upon it, and by faith and trust in you, as we partake, we have the promise that we will live forever with you. So bless this bread as a symbol of your broken body. And as we partake, may we partake worthily so that we can live with you in eternity and to partake of it anew with you when you shall come in your eternal kingdom. For we ask these blessings through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice. Hymn number 306.
I'm
Number 294, would you be free from your burden of sin? There's what?
Power
in the blood. Number 294.
Has everyone been saved?
The bread you hold on your hand is a symbol of the body of Jesus Christ that was broken for you and me. Let us prayerfully partake of this bread as we give thanks to God for the sacrifice of Christ. We may eat.
The text on his blood that was spilt for us comes to us from Mark 14, 23 to 25. And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, "This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
As far as possible, let us kneel to pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we want to thank you for your love. Thank you for your promises made in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, in which you say that you will put enmity between the devil and the humans. Lord, you kept your promise in John 3, 16, for you so loved the world that you gave your only son. Lord, we thank you for this sacrifice, Lord. You told us that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. There is no salvation. But Lord, we thank you again. But we know that sin is not something for us to play with. So Lord, we ask you to bless this wine, bless this juice, as it's a symbol of your blood, the blood of Christ, Lord. Help us to be better Christians so we could grow in you and lead others to know you. Bless us, teach us, bless this blood, we bless this wine. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Hymn number 336, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins.
Yeah.
Has everyone been served? Thank you. The cup you hold on your hand is a symbol of the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for you and me. Let us prayerfully partake in remembrance and gratitude to the blood of Christ. Let us drink.
We have to sing a cappella, right? Okay. There's your note. Let's sing it a cappella. Thank you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was.
109. We'll sing the first and last stanza of 109, Marvelous Grace of Our Loving Lord. 109. First and last stanza, please.
Invite our deacons to wait on us. We always collect a special offering. We call it the Good Samaritan offering. It goes towards meeting the needs of our members. So I'll ask for our deacons to wait on us. And as they do so, let me take this opportunity to encourage you to join us. We've just been reminded about the opportunity and grace of serving. And today, at 4 o'clock, we've made it our custom that as a church, the good news that God has made known to us in Christ does not remain with us. So today at 4 o'clock, we want to go to our neighbors and share with them a simple magazine. It's a focus magazine. And along with it, we have put together a message in a card, seasonal greetings, and wishing them the blessings of God in 2017. We have picked out about 1,500 homes that are around our church, and we have identified the streets and the number of homes in each of those streets, and we have packaged them in a good envelope. We hope to put an address to each of them. What we are doing is to invite you to join us at 4 o'clock. We will divide in 20 groups, and we will be able to go and drop a card in each home. This is a long-term plan. This December, we will drop a card, just ask, praying for God's blessings for them. In January, we drop another card for on health. So every third Sabbath of the month in the afternoon, we communicate with our neighbors with a little gift. Our intention is that in the month of March, we'll be able to knock each of the doors on Mother's Day and share a gift to each of the mothers there. And then in June, we have a gift for the Father's Day. Now, remember, only those who sow can look forward to harvesting. We don't know how many of these will touch our heart, but we believe that as we spread the word, God will use His Spirit to sow the word. And this is something all of us can do. Each of us, and I'm saying to my leaders, we still have a chance to drop literature in people's homes. Before that door closes, let's maximize use of it. So join us today at 4 o'clock. But I also want to encourage you to join us at 5, because between 5 and 6:30, we want to engage in what we call a review of 2016. We believe God has blessed you to grow in this church. We'd like you to share with us what aspects of your faith have grown in 2016. what activities have helped you grow, and what it is we can do to improve them. Amen. As leaders, we want to make sure that whatever it is we are doing is relevant and is blessing what is happening in your life. So join us at 5 so that you can help us know how you are being blessed and how we can improve on that, so that ultimately all of us can become what God intends us to do. So join us at 4 for the community outreach, and again at 5 for our review. And for those who are visiting, we always have lunch. You know, church for us is a whole day. You come and study in the morning, you worship, you fellowship with us, then we outreach the community, and then we celebrate. So please plan to be with us for the whole day. If you need to make a phone call to make changes to the afternoon program, I can assure you they will not be, you know, they may be disappointed, but they can cope with it. So plan to be with us for the day.
Amen. Hebrews 10 verse 37 says, "For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry." So communion not only looks backwards, but it looks forward to that time when he will come. And we're going to ask you to stand as we sing number 428, as we look by faith to that sweet by and by. Hymn number 428, "There's a land that is fairer than day."
Closing prayer. I'd like to invite anyone who has need for special prayers, if you can make your way to the front. Indeed, Lord. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on the beautiful shore. Father, we just stand before you today, just lifting you up. Lifting you up because of who you are. Because of what you have done for us. Father, we just want to thank you for the many blessings. We just want to thank you from the depths of our hearts, knowing that you loved us even before we loved you. Regardless whether or not we love you, you love us. And because of your love for us, Father, your blood was shed on Calvary. We are unworthy, Lord. We are unworthy. But we just want to thank you that despite of who we are, despite of what we've done, we can come to you, we can speak with you, we can commune with you just as we have today. And we know that your arms are opened wide to receive us. Father, we just want to take the time out, Lord, for all those who made their way to the front this afternoon. For whatever reasons, Father, as our faces differ, so our problems differ. So, Father, we just want to, whatever it is at this moment that is burdening our hearts, Lord, we just want to give it to you. Father, as we have taken your body, we've eaten your body and tasted your blood. Father, we pray that you will come and deliver us now. And that our problems, Father, we pray that you will take away our burdens. You are the burden bearer. So we just want to give that over to you at this time. Father, for those who are sick, we pray, Father, that you will give them comfort, that you will give them healing, and that they will know, Father, that you are there for them. All they need to do is call on your name. Father, we pray for those who have lost loved ones, Lord. We know that you are the comforter, and we just want to say a special prayer for the DeLisa family. Father, our heart goes out to them. Father, but we know that you are there and you are holding them up. And those who mourn with them, Father, we pray that you will keep them also. Because your word said, death, where is thy sting? Grave, where is thy victory? You have already overcome. So we know, Father, that as long as we keep holding on to you, as long as we hold the faith, that we will see our loved ones again. Father, we pray that you will continue to bless us, Lord, as we serve you and as we serve the community. And we pray, Father, that when we leave here today, our lives will be changed, that we will not leave here the same person as we came, but we will leave as individuals with a purpose who are on a mission for God. Father, we just want to thank you for this opportunity, and we just want to take this opportunity to let you know how much we love you. Thank you, Lord. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
As you take your seats and as the platform party leave, we're going to continue that song of victory. We're going to sing the first and last stanza of hymn number 428, what we've just been singing. Number 428, first and last, as the platform party leaves the platform. Number 428, there's a land that is fair. Okay, we'll sing all stanzas. Number 428, there's a land that is fairer than day. You may be seated for these, because most people are sitting, so you can all sit, that's fine. Or stand if you want, it's up to you. There's a land that is fairer than day. stanza. To our bountiful Father above, last stanza.
To our bountiful Father above.